Welcome back. In this lesson, we'll explore a foundational concept of how AWS users actually access the wide variety of AWS services available today. We'll use the classic personality types of introverts and extroverts to help understand important AWS networking concepts. So many AWS services can be thought of as extroverts. These are the services where they, you know, love being the center of attention. It's really easy for them to make connections or friendships, and they enjoy typically being in busy places with lots going on. Now, on the other hand, some AWS services are introverts. These are the AWS services that like spending time alone or connecting with a few very close friends. They typically don't like being the center of attention and generally just like to keep to themselves. Now, just like with people, AWS services can have traits of both personality types, exhibiting the tendencies of both introverts and extroverts, kind of a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde type of scenario. Now, actually creating this hybrid situation, though, takes intentional configuration effort on the customer side to really bridge between these two different personality types. So now let's put this in a bit more AWS context to understand better. So for the AWS extrovert services, these are the services that are accessible directly from the public internet. Again, these services are great at being the center of attention and want to be available to talk to a lot of users as easily as possible. Now, the AWS introvert services want to keep as private as possible. They typically have a castle built around them to avoid talking to others. The castle typically prevents direct communication from the public internet to the services that operate inside of it. Now, as for the hybrid mode, the extrovert services typically have a lot of different armor options available. So though they're the center of attention on the huge public party of the public internet, they can choose what armor to wear to sort of protect them from those they don't want to talk to. For the introvert services, living in their castle of isolation, heavily guarded gates or tunnels can be put in place to allow specific things into or out of the service through those castle walls. Now, to limit the scope of this video as part of the AWS foundational concepts here, we'll just be looking at some of the typical ways AWS services can be reached from a networking perspective. This is in no way intended to be a comprehensive overview of AWS networking and all the different security configurations possible with AWS services, but knowing these key distinctions between introvert and extrovert, essentially the concept of private and public services, this early on in your AWS study phase will really help you understand more advanced networking concepts as we get to those further later on in the course. So what do these different public and private personalities of AWS services look like in a more practical sense? And then how does this concept influence networking communication when using these AWS services? Well, let's build out a simple example here to really help understand these important concepts of AWS service networking. Now, let's say we have a simple website. Maybe it's a self-hosted blog site about the latest Viking fashion trends. We have a web server of some type running the website, and the site needs a database to store some user information on for email mailing list. Now, since it's a fashion blog site, we can expect there'll be a lot of images within it, so we'll need a place to store all those as well. Maybe our Viking fashion fans can also up their own photos of the latest fashion trends or download images uploaded by other users. So what AWS services should we use to build out this site? Well, for the web server, let's say we decide to use an Amazon EC2 instance. Then for the database, we have a small Amazon RDS database. And for the images, we use Amazon S3 for just a low-cost storage option. And then we got to think what else we've got going on for our simple blog site scenario here. We, of course, need to call out the internet as that big network party where we're expecting all our users' traffic to come through to actually reach the site. So we have all our Viking fashion users of our blog site, and they'll be using their home internet connections to reach our blog. So we have some AWS services picked out now, and we know we need to use the public internet for users to reach our site. So next we'll build out some of the AWS account and networking components to visually see how we can sort of plumb all these things together to get our site working and accessible. To start, we'll of course have our AWS account as that type of logical container for all our AWS resources within it. An account is our logical container boundary for various billing, administrative, and even security purposes. Then next, we'll have a specific AWS region to pick that we'll deploy our services into. Now, we'll cover AWS regions and the differences between global and regional scoped AWS services in future lessons. But really, for now, just know that we'll have our blog, web server, and database essentially living in a specific geographic region. Then within this region, we'll build our heavily guarded castle that some of our services will live inside, a protected home for our introverted services. This castle is called a virtual private cloud, or VPC. This VPC is completely isolated from the internet in its default state. In fact, VPCs are isolated from really everything. Even in the same AWS account, if we have other VPCs set up, by default, no communication is possible between any of the VPCs or any of the resources that would be deployed inside of it. VPCs are critical to understand when working with AWS and, of course, the many AWS certification topic areas. Again, we'll be covering VPCs in depth in future lessons, so I'm just really glossing over a lot of the VPC details here, so you can keep the focus on understanding these public and private AWS service concepts for now. So with our private VPC castle in place now, let's move our web server running on EC2 and our database here using the managed database service Amazon RDS into the VPC. EC2 instances and RDS databases are required by AWS to run inside a VPC. They're essentially born complete introverts and destined to live inside the castle walls of our VPC. Now, for our storage requirements, we'll use the Amazon Simple Storage Service, or S3, for all our image files. Amazon S3 differs a bit from our EC2 instances and RDS database in that it has a public endpoint to access the service. This public endpoint means the Amazon S3 service is directly accessible from the internet. Extroverted public AWS services really love hanging out with the public internet party, and they make themselves very approachable and easy to talk to. So the key thing to really get from this whole lesson is understanding that some AWS services are made publicly accessible, and that this is all done through what's called a public endpoint. Private services live in a VPC, and they're not accessible directly from the internet, unless you specifically configure the VPC networking configurations and all the routing to allow for this internet traffic to come in and out of the VPC. Now, these extroverted AWS services with their public endpoints all kind of exist in their own castle as well. As you can probably imagine, AWS has some pretty extensive networking capabilities as part of their global infrastructure. Now, we'll be going over a lot of this global infrastructure topic in future lessons, but for now, just know that these AWS services with these public endpoints are essentially part of a public market area owned by the AWS kingdom. And these public endpoint-enabled services are designed by AWS to be used directly through the public internet. So back to our blog site now, if we were to visualize some high-level network traffic flows, they'd look something like this. Our web server on our EC2 instance here is running in our very private VPC, alongside our RDS database. Now, as they're in the same VPC, they can communicate with each other and we can access the database. Again, I'm glossing over a lot of the details with subnets, security groups, routing, and so forth, but we're just trying to keep things simple here for now, and just know we'll dive into those details in later lessons. Now, our users need to be able to reach this EC2 instance that our blog site is running on from the internet. But we just went through explaining how this VPC castle is completely isolated from the internet. This VPC isolation is the default. However, as AWS customers, we really have the control to decide if we need to configure the VPC to allow traffic to and from the internet. In this case, we'll need what's called an Internet Gateway to enable this internet traffic routing capability. We can think of this internet gateway as a sort of big drawbridge doorway going over our VPC moat, allowing internet traffic through the castle walls of our VPC. So now that our Viking fashion fan audience can reach our blog site from the public internet and our EC2 instance can talk to the database, but what about our image files? Now, don't forget the Amazon S3 service is enabled with a public endpoint. So it's one of these public services living in the public AWS kingdom, specifically designed to be reached over the public internet. So what happens now when our web server running on the EC2 instance needs to retrieve image files from the S3 storage service to display on our site? Since the Amazon S3 service is a public AWS service, the EC2 instance traffic here would actually go out through the Internet Gateway so that it can get out of our VPC castle and join the Internet traffic party. Then through the public Internet, it can access the S3 service through its public endpoint. The return traffic path here just goes the opposite way from the S3 service through the public Internet, then routed back to the EC2 instance again. Now, I know I'm repeating myself a little bit here, but again, I just wanted to mention that we're just really looking at a simplified example for this lesson here. There's a lot of details not shown with the network configuration, IP addressing, network address translation or NAT, and different routing configurations and other potential security filtering of the traffic. I just keep calling this out as I don't want you to really get this visual etched into your brain that this is all there is to AWS networking. But we're really just building on the foundation of our understanding here, and we'll add layers of detail on this throughout the course. The key thing to grasp here with this simplified network traffic flow is that even though we're using AWS services, if you have private resources in a VPC and they need to use a public AWS service, they do so through the public internet by default. Now, let's just say our fashion images are super top secret for some reason. Maybe sending those images over the public internet isn't ideal for the kingdom. If we pretend to have some sort of high-ranking knight in our secure and private VPC castle, and they're sent on a mission to bring back some fashion drawings from the public S3 service to our blog king in the castle, we can picture them leaving our secure VPC walls through the internet gateway. Then all of a sudden, they're in this very busy area full of potentially spies and eavesdroppers, trying to learn about our secret fashion ideas. It's not an ideal situation to expose our knights to, as we risk someone outside our castle walls from getting access to our important fashion information. Well, we know now that Amazon S3 is a public AWS service with its public endpoint, so it can be easily accessed over the public internet. So really, what's the alternative to sending our knights out into the scary public internet? The alternative to reaching these public AWS services from our private AWS services in our VPC is using what's called a gateway or interface endpoint. These gateway endpoints and private endpoints enable our private AWS services inside our VPC castle to reach these public AWS services, yet keep all that network traffic within the special AWS network kingdom. And this therefore removes the need to really use the public internet to reach them. If we have the VPC gateway endpoint for S3 set up in our VPC, we can think of this as enabling a private secret tunnel the guards can use to reach the S3 service and get our secret fashion drawings back to us. Through this gateway endpoint, our knights are really never exposed to the public internet of spies and thieves. All that traffic is kept within the special AWS network of their global infrastructure that AWS owns and operates within their AWS services kingdom. Now, there's actually a number of ways to keep our network communication private within AWS, even when using these AWS public services. Now, we'll be exploring a lot of these different ways in future lessons, using things like AWS Direct Connect for private communications between our AWS VPC and perhaps to other physical office locations or on-premises data centers, and using things like virtual private networking or VPN connectivity, exploring as well like AWS private endpoints to create these private links between our VPCs and different public AWS services. Well, we went through quite a bit here, but I hope this has really been helpful to help you grasp the idea of the different public and private personality types of AWS services. This understanding will be really important as we progress through the course and really explore more about the AWS global infrastructure, VPCs, and other AWS networking concepts in future lessons. So thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next lessons.